straight away to game theory with Pierpaolo. Please, eat the presenters over there.
Yeah, so let's see if this works. Good. Okay, so I'm going to start with a 5 minute crash course in game theory, just to have everybody on the same page and also to illustrate some of the notation I will be using. So this is a game which is similar to the Centipede game, for those of you who have heard about it. The story that you can tell to describe this game is very simple. You know, a machine put a dollar on the table, then N is the first mover, and can choose to go down and pick the dollar, and then the game ends. Or otherwise continue, and in that case the machine puts another dollar on the table, and Bob can decide, could grab the $2, or continue. If continue, the machine puts the third dollar on the table, and there are only $3 to be put on the table. So at that point, the game is going to end, and can grab the $3 by going down or by continuing, so to speak. She leaves them to Bob. Okay, so it's a very easy story to tell, easier than the usual Centipede game. So in my talk, I'm going to try to give you a perspective on dynamic epistemic game theory. And by epistemic, I mean it's a formal analysis of how players think about each other. And dynamic takes into account the dynamics of the game, so the fact that the game is sequential. I will limit my attention to games that have the feature of this one of having, you know, perfect information about previous moves and players who play, who take turns, so they play on time. These are called games of perfect information. I'm going to consider only finite games, and games where there are, you know, whenever you have to take a decision, basically you are not bothered by ties if you expect a deterministic continuation. So you can be indifferent if your expectations are such that you're not sure how things are going to continue, but whenever you're sure about continuations, there are no ties, okay? So I'm going to talk about strategies and the interpretation of strategies. So first of all, from a mathematical point of view, strategies are functions that somehow deterministically select actions as a function of an input, and the input is which node of a game is reached, okay? And here in my talk, nodes will be identified with sequences of actions, okay? So the primitives are actions, the rules of the game say which sequences of actions are allowed, and sequences of actions are the nodes. So therefore the empty sequence is the first node, the sequence that contains only capital C is a node, the sequence that contains capital C followed by small c is another node, okay? And I will call these sequences histories with the letter H for history. So what is a strategy for N? A strategy for N has to specify what to do at each node of N, irrespective of the fact that N, according to her strategy, should go down or not, okay? So it is, you know, there are two nodes with two actions, so there are two times two strategies. All basically, all the order pairs, you know, of a letter taken from here and an action letter taken from here and an action letter taken from here. So I wrote them down here in this table. And for the case of Bob, there is a one-to-one relationship between strategies and the two actions he has, because he has only one opportunity to move, okay? He has only one node, okay? Although when in this table we write the letter C, the meaning is that this is the instruction that say continue if N continues, okay? It is not something that says Bob continues, because in order to continue, Bob has to be able to move first, okay? So in terms of sequences of actions, you know, continue, the action continue of Bob can occur only if N continues, okay? So this in this table, this has to be interpreted as an instruction. You know, if the input is N continued at the first node, then the output has to be continued. Okay? And there are only two possible such instructions. And so I take, there is an obvious way to map pairs of strategies into terminal histories. The terminal histories are those that end with a pair of payoffs, okay? And I gave an example here, so I call this mapping the path function, so pi is for path. So if I take, for example, a strategy of N of continuing first and if given the opportunity, go down later, and the strategy of Bob of continuing if given the opportunity, this pair of strategy produces the path where N start continuing, then Bob, given his instruction, continues, and then N, given her instruction, goes down. And so we reach the terminal history CC prime, and which corresponds to the outcome 3-0. Okay? And by the way, I don't want you to, you know, there are many, many moving parts in this talk, so let's try to fix idea on something and simplify some dimensions. Let's say that, you know, players, the monetary, there are only monetary consequences, so these numbers are dollars, and players are selfish monetary payoff maximizers, okay? And there is common knowledge of this fact. Like, and there is common knowledge, of course, of the rules of the game, okay? So basically, the point of this talk is the following, that we analyze, often we analyze game in their strategic form, which is this table, and even though in the epistemic analysis, in dynamic epistemic analysis of games, we also look at the tree, still this strategic form plays a big role, and it, basically in the traditional analysis, which cover most of my work, by the way, these pairs of strategies belong to what we call the state of the world, okay? And when I say the state of the world, I mean something very different from what decision theorists call state of nature, for example. The state of the world is just a description of everything that matters, okay? And according to the traditional theory, a description of everything that matters must also include the strategy that somehow characterizes and the strategy that somehow, when I say somehow characterize, I'm trying not to use the phrase the strategy chosen by N and the strategy chosen by Bob. Why? Well, because my point here is really very simple. The object of choice are actions, not strategies, okay? Players cannot choose strategy. If, suppose that N could choose the strategy CC prime, then the game would not be this game, okay? We would have a different game. A game where, you know, N basically delegates a machine to play in her place, and this machine executes, you know, a program, instructions, to do as specified by the strategy, okay? This is a different game. So whenever there is some kind of possibility to commit, either covertly, namely, with the other players being unaware of it, not observing it, or overtly, this has to, according to this methodology, this has to be shown explicitly in the tree, in the rules of the game. And therefore, no further commitment possibility is allowed by construction. Okay, so mantra, strategies cannot be chosen. Yet, according to the traditional theory of dynamic interactive epistemology, strategies are part of the states of the world. So today I'm trying to give you something which is, as the previous talk, in between a tutorial and also a presentation of some more original stuff. I guess that trying to present what is original, namely my way to do dynamic interactive epistemology without putting strategies in the state of the world, I hope I will be able to give you some perspective on, you know, dynamic interactive epistemology in general. Okay, so let me, to have everybody on the same page, let me tell you about the algorithm that most game theorists are obsessed with when we talk about these games with perfect information. The algorithm is called backward induction, okay? So backward induction is the following argument. We have to start from a so-called pre-terminal node, so a node such that every choice terminates the game. And for the node, obviously there is a best choice for the player, for the moving player, which is down for n. Okay, and therefore we can report the corresponding payoff pair to that preterminal node. And in general, we have to do it for every preterminal node. Fortunately, we have only one here, so we are already done for this step. Okay. Now you go backward and you go to pre-preterminal nodes. And there is only one here, the node of Bob. And Bob has to compare his payoff, okay, basically for each value that has been assigned with the previous step. So, of course, going down gives him 2 by the rules of the game, and continuing according to the previous steps gives him 0, because this is the payoff pair that, according to the algorithm, we associated to the preterminal node. And, well, he likes better 2 than 0, so he goes down. Okay, and therefore we now associate to this pre-preterminal node the payoff pair 0, 2. And then we go to the pre-pre-preterminal node, which happens to be the root of the game, and again, n compares 1 with 0, and she prefers 1, and she goes down. And in this way, we have identified 2 things, okay, which are obviously related to each other. One thing, we have identified a unique path or terminal node, which in this case is to go down immediately with this 1-0 outcome. And this is called the backward induction outcome. Okay, so backward induction in my slides is BI. Whenever you see BI, it means backward induction. But we have also identified a strategy pair, which is this one. DD prime for N and small d for Bob. Okay? Now, I guess that everybody is able to understand from a strategy forum of a game what are the Nash equilibria. This game has 2 Nash equilibria in pure strategies, these 2, and they have the same outcome. So as you can see, Nash equilibrium relaxes somewhat, you know, the results of backward induction, but in games like this, it yields the same outcome. In different games like the one I'm going to discuss next, there are Nash equilibrium that yield a completely different outcome than backward induction, but backward induction always identify 1 Nash equilibrium, okay? Now, there is another, so we performed an algorithm, which is given by a recursion, okay? Now I'm going to perform a different algorithm on the strategy form, which is also given by a recursion. And I do it because it mirrors something that is actually done on the tree, but talking about strategy. So there is a kind of bastard algorithm that I like a lot, also because I rediscovered it by myself when I was a kid, okay, although it had already been invented. And it was a compromise between working with the tree and working with the strategic form. What I'm showing you mirrors that algorithm exactly in games like this, and it is called the iterated deletion of weakly dominated strategies, okay? Weakly dominated strategies. So for the case of N, notice that the strategy of always continuous CC prime is dominated by CD prime. But the dominance is only weak. Why? Because if she continues and Bob goes down, what she would have done later is immaterial, okay? But of course, weak dominance matters a lot, even if it is only weak, because it identifies what is rational to do for N, you know, if just in case Bob gives her the chance to move at the last node. And then it is clear that she has to go down because she is selfish, okay? So what we do, we can do a first step of elimination and delete or strike in this first step this strategy, okay? And this is by weak dominance. Now, how can we go on? Well, let me mention that there are 2, so to speak, theories or relevant algorithms that are both based on clear and explicit epistemic assumptions that I will try to clarify later if I have time. And one says, look, it is okay to do weak dominance in the first round, but after that you're only allowed to do strict dominance. And if you ask why, well, I cannot explain, okay? Right now I cannot explain. But it is a perfectly well justified argument, okay? And there is another argument that says, no, you should keep eliminating weakly dominated strategies, okay? So it's okay to do weak dominance also at the second, third, and fourth round. So now, in terms of weak dominance here, we have in the residual matrix you get after the first elimination, you have a weak dominance for Bob, because you see that D weakly dominates C, because you have 2 versus 0 and you have ties otherwise. Okay, so in our second step, we delete C. Okay? And then we have, you know, we have a residual matrix with only, you know, 3 boxes in a column, and it's clear that in this residual matrix, you know, the row CD is bad because it gives 0 instead of 1. Third step, and now we are done. And we are done, and we get the 2 boxes that corresponds to the 2 Nash equilibria. Okay, and so we get the backward induction outcome. We do not get exactly the backward induction strategies, but as Fabio was explaining, these 2 strategies are realization equivalent because they yield the same terminal node, however Bob behaves. Okay, so this is a background. I also introduce a little bit of the notation I'm going to use. Okay. So basically, I start saying what is the topic of this talk. So the mathematical tools I'm going to use are called epistemic structure, and I will consider a specific kind, which is called tie structures. And in these epistemic structures, there will be states of the world that determine the truth value of conditional statements, okay? They do not determine only the truth value of, you know, they determine the truth values of conditional statements like, you know, if Bob were given the opportunity to move, he would think that N would go down if given the opportunity to move. Something like that, okay? These conditional statements are given truth values by the state of the world of this epistemic structure. Now, a distinctive feature of this talk is that I'm only going to use and give a truth value, so to speak, to epistemic conditionals. No, so conditional of the form, if player I learned history H, okay, then he would believe event E with probability at least P, okay? So my epistemic structures will give, in some sense, full value, truth value to this. And what I'm saying smells of logic and modal logic, but there is no mathematical logic here. Although I know that some of these things can be done with mathematical logic, okay? This is entirely, you know, set theoretic. So I mentioned the motivation, why, so I will not have instead what I call behavioral conditional of the form, you know, if Bob were given the opportunity to move, he would go down. This is what I call a behavioral conditional. Such behavioral conditional are not given a truth value by my states of the world. So they do not appear in my states of the world, okay? And basically, I gave my motivation, you know, strategies cannot be reversibly chosen, and basically, we reinterpret strategies as beliefs of players about how they would behave. And such beliefs come out of their planning. So this is my interpretation of strategies. So strategies are just a part of the description of a mental state, the mental state of the player, or how he thinks. And basically, are the part that describe how he thinks about himself. Okay, his plan. And plan, to me, is a totally epistemic notion. And as I said, I'm going to consider games of perfect information. Here there are some references, you know, unlike previous tutorials, these are not, you know, works that had, you know, a deep and vast impact on theoretical economic literature. This is the background literature for this talk, okay? I'm not citing von Neumann-Morgenstern, you know. Okay, and in the interest of time, I'm not commenting on it, but some of those are more mathematical, some of those are more conceptual. Okay, so this is the roadmap, and so let me start to give you a preview, especially for those who are already conversant with these mathematical objects. Let me start to give a preview of what I call epistemic structure. So, in a game, I have a set of histories, a set of paths or terminal histories, and I have strategies for player I and suppose there are two players, then minus I is the co-player, okay? And then there are the traditional epistemic structure used to do epistemic game theory and dynamic epistemic game theory. I call them S-based structure because the states of the world basically specify, you know, the contingent behavior of players and what they think. So this T should be reminiscent for type and think, okay? Whenever you see T, it's type, think type, okay? So these are the states of the world in the traditional structure, and basically we are going to consider, you know, for each player a family of conditioning events, and these conditioning events have the following form. You know, since we are at history H, the other players must have chosen a strategy in this set, which is the set of all strategies of co-players allowing H, okay? And therefore I can draw some conclusion from this, you know, my beliefs can be conditioned on this event, which is an event about the strategies and what other players think, but notice that you can never observe directly what other players think, okay? And this is something that I will keep in today's talk too. And the structures I'm going to use today instead are Z-based structures. They are based on the set of paths as things that are part of the external world, not of the think, not of the mental part, not of the mental part of players, okay? So this will be my set of states of the world, a path, and then a profile of types describing how players think, okay? And as for beliefs, you know, basically there will be mappings that for every type which characterize how a player think, I will associate not just one probabilistic beliefs, but as many probabilistic beliefs as there are histories in the game, okay? And of course they will have to be tied to each other according to the standard rules of conditional probabilities, and therefore that's why I get a subset of this set of functions from histories to probability measures, okay? So this is the preview of the type of structure I'm comparing. So now I'm going to consider a game which is much simpler in terms of its strategic analysis than the centipede game. It has an economic interpretation. So what you see on the left is not the strategic form of the game. It is just an output function, okay, that describes describes basically the payoffs of two duopolies according to the combination of choices to produce a lot and to produce a little, okay? So I have a Stackelberg leader, okay, who can produce a high amount or a low amount, high up, low down in my game tree representation, and I have a follower who can produce a low amount, left, or a high amount, right, okay? And since it is a Stackelberg game, you know, Anne, the leader, plays first, she can go up or down, and then Bob plays later, and, you know, I'm differentiating the action of, you know, choosing a low amount for Bob according to what Bob knows about the action of Anne, okay? And those are payoffs I derive from a standard duopoly, you know, model, okay? Now, this game has a standard backward induction solution, but let's go slowly, okay? So, Let me first describe what I call a behavioral conditional, okay? Bob would go right, given up. This is what I call a behavioral conditional. And let me describe the standard reasoning about this game. The standard reasoning about this game has behavioral conditionals in the states of the world, so they are events, and therefore beliefs about such events are allowed, so, and beliefs that Bob would go right, given up. And this is a belief about the behavioral conditional. This is part of the what I call the traditional analysis, okay? Given, you know, if N chose up, given this, if N chose up, she would believe Bob goes right. So basically, from the previous line, you know, we can derive also the second line. This is, again, part of the traditional analysis, okay? So in the traditional analysis, we both have behavioral conditionals, beliefs about conditionals, and also beliefs about the beliefs of opponents. And however, instead, in our analysis, we only have actual actions, namely paths, sequences of actions, and we will have conditional beliefs about actions and about the beliefs of others, okay? And this will create, this, in my opinion, imposes a lot of discipline, but it creates some initial difficulties that can be overcome well, okay? So I'm trying to describe these difficulties. So let me start, yes.
States like Bob would go right, given up, represented? I mean, what kind of...
This is not a state. This is an event in the traditional analysis. Okay? And there, in the traditional analysis, basically a state of the world is a list of objects, okay, that for every player specify a strategy of that player and
okay,
how
so
he thinks.
Picked out of the strategy.
And once you have the strategy, and the strategy is interpreted not in an epistemic sense, but in an objective sense.
Okay. So it could be a set of strategies, in
right,
effect.
It's like a computer program, you know. The state of the world says, this is the computer program describing the behavior of Bob. Okay.
Yeah, a set of all
right. Okay. So basically, we will have some kind of mapping that in our case it will be a projection mapping, it doesn't really matter, that for every state of the world, little omega specifies the strategy of each player I, and this mapping we can call sigma just to have a label for it, okay? Now, basically, we can say that the statement Bob would go right given up is a false statement at the state of the world omega, if and only if the strategy of Bob at omega belongs to this set that contains these two strategies, you know, L, R, L, L, because the first component, which is the instruction to be carried out after up, is not right, is left, okay? This is you know, the totally intuitive and straightforward way, you know, to give truth values to these behavioral conditions in these structures that have strategies in the states of the world, okay? Now, so we can, you know, we can represent, oh, by the way, all the symbols you see on the board that are, you know, can be interpreted informally as events or things, operators that pick events and map them to other events, this is all mathematically formalized. For the traditional theory in previous papers, for what I'm going to say today, you know, that's the new theory in this paper, okay? So don't worry, I'm not just throwing symbols. I think these symbols are evocative, but everything can be given a precise mathematical definition, okay? So basically, we can say the following. So if Bob is, this is according to the traditional analysis, okay? If Bob is rational, okay, the rationality of Bob implies that Bob plays the strategy LR. And this is what you get from backward induction, basically. Okay, you see where capital L, because 1 is larger than 0, and down small r, because 3 is larger than 2. Okay? So the rationality of Bob implies this. And when I put this in brackets, LR in brackets, it means the set of all states of the world where Bob plays, so to speak, or is characterized by strategy LR. Okay? Now, if N believes in the rationality of Bob, by this we mean she believes it with probability 1, okay, then by monotonicity of belief with priority one, she has to believe that he plays the strategy LR. Okay? Then we go on. So we also have a specification of conditional beliefs in such structures, and by a built-in independence assumption that in the traditional analysis often, more often than not, implicit, okay, we get the following, that so N, if N believes LR, after, you know, condition on her choosing up, she would believe left, okay? And this is something that comes out of that analysis in a kind of mechanical way, okay? And furthermore, conditional on her choosing down, she would believe R. So these are conditional beliefs, and these conditional beliefs can be given a meaning, a truth value in this semantics, you know, epistemic structure, okay? And well, considering how the rules of the game are, this allows N to give a utility value to her choices, because she believes that she will get three utils or $3 conditional on U, and she would get one util conditional on D. Okay. So from the rationality of N and the rationality of Bob, and the assumption that N is certain that Bob is rational, we can derive, and all these inclusions, you know, informally, I interpret as logical implications. Formally, they are just inclusions between events, okay? Weak, by the way, this is weak inclusion, okay? I have no need for the difference between weak and strict. So we obtain this pair of strategy from these assumptions, which in turn, because we have a path function, implies a particular path, the path up left, okay? So this is how, this is an example of how the traditional analysis proceeds. Let's see our analysis. In our analysis, strategy is just planning, okay? A plan, and a plan is in the mind of players, is not part of, you know, it's just in the mind of players. So what I call epistemic is what is in the mind of players. So here strategies will be in the mind of players. So I can describe an assumption which I call rational planning, which is entirely epistemic, okay? And this rational planning, for example, for Bob means that Bob is certain that if N, if N went up, Bob would believe he's going left with priority one, okay? Why? Because it is the best choice for him, one against zero. And he also believed condition on D, he would choose right with priority one, okay? So the point is I have, you know, a double interpretation for these conditions. They both describe, in some sense, conditional, deterministic conditional probabilities, okay? But the point is that by introspection, Bob understands at the beginning of the game that this is how he's going to evaluate these conditionals, if he's given the input U or if he's given the input D. Okay, so he has all this conditional evaluation in his mind, you know, so to speak, atemporally or at the beginning of the game. Then we are imposing a notion of what I call material consistency, and the word material comes from the material implication in logic, because you will see it is reminiscent of material implication in logic. So a consistency between path and plan. Okay, so basically, what does we are going to define, so what this says that the path does not contradict the plan. This is what I call material consistency, okay? The state of the world specifies one particular path, and along that path, you don't see that particular player doing things different from what he planned. This is what I call material consistency. Is this clear intuitively? No, not yet. By the way, I have, in some sense, I have no need for dynamic consistency in my analysis, in a sense, because dynamic consistency is about choosing strategies that cannot be chosen, but pretending you can choose strategies, and then checking that you never have incentives to deviate, because since you cannot really choose strategies, you have to check this, okay? Here you only choose actions. And that basically kills, in some sense, the dynamic consistency issue. Of course, you can you can always connect to dynamic consistency, but it is not really an issue in my analysis, okay? Okay, so I'm going to define rationality as follows, you know? The guy, say Bob, is a rational planner, he plans rationally, and, you know, along the path that's specified by the true state of the world, he doesn't contradict his plan by choosing an action that contradicts the plan, okay? That's different from what the plan has specified, okay? Now, the rationality of Bob implies the following event, namely that either up left or down right happen, okay? Either up left or down right. So, rationality of Bob implies that these two things, only these two things are possible, okay? Now, in this setup that I'm going to use today, there is no event like L dot R is the strategy of Bob, because states of reward do not specify strategies, okay? So a belief like N believes that Bob would go left after up and he would go right after down is not expressible when I use these type structures where strategies are not part of the state, objective strategies are not part of the state of the world. So behavioral conditionals are not part of the state of the world, okay? So let's try to work with what we have so far, okay? And we can say, okay, let's say N believes that Bob is rational at the beginning of the game, okay? This implies that she believes that only these two paths are possible. Not that she is choosing the first action in these paths, okay? But the problem is that this does not imply that N would believe left conditional on choosing U, and she would believe right conditional on choosing D, okay? And why? For a very, in a sense, silly reason, is that we are going to use by all means, the rules of conditional probabilities whenever we can, okay? But if N is certain that she will go down, and therefore, so this is written, this is not well written. Anyway, if N is certain that she will go down, okay? Basically, we cannot derive this implication because she can, there is no way to tie what she believes after going up, which is a zero probability event from her point of view, to what she believed at the beginning of the game, okay? No way to tie it just using the rules of conditional probabilities that say, you know, when there is zero denominator, sorry, you cannot use the rules of conditional probabilities. You've got to use something else. But we are going to use something else, don't worry, okay? So, basically, recall that the rationality of Bob implies that only those two paths are possible, and if N, again, this is a mistake, I mean, if N is certain that she would go down, then this implication does not necessarily hold, okay? I mean, there are epistemic structures in which this happens. You know, you don't have this containment, okay? So I'm repeating here. So basically, the point is, if N plans to choose down, okay, which is a non-backward induction action, okay, then you can have the following that N believes that only one of these two paths is possible, which is the implication of the rationality of Bob, okay? And yet, she does not, conditional on up, she does not believe that Bob would go left. And this is a problem for me in this setting, because I have to assign a value to the action up, okay? And in order to assign a value on the action of the, about, on action up, I would like to be able that N believes that Bob would go left, condition on up. So the way I assign values to actions is to use beliefs that are conditional on those actions being taken, okay? But, you know, if I have this, I don't know how to perform something that looks like, you know, the obvious strategic analysis of the game. And actually, under these assumptions of, you know, rationality and initial belief in rationality, a Nash equilibrium would obtain, but not necessarily the perfect Nash equilibrium that is obtained via backward induction. So there are two Nash equilibria in this game, okay? And one of them is down right, okay? And it is down right, and the interpretation is that N condition on going up would believe that Bob would go right with sufficiently high probability, okay? So in some sense, it represents a non-credible threat. From our point of view, non-credible. So that we have not yet learned how to eliminate it using a formal analysis in this setting, okay? So this is a Nash equilibrium path, okay? But it is imperfect. So it is a theorem that in these games, two-stage games, rationality and initial belief in rationality imply Nash equilibrium, but not a perfect or backward induction Nash equilibrium. So now I'm giving you one way out, which works very well for a perfect information game, which is the strong belief way out. What do I mean by strong belief? I say informally, N strongly believes an event E, if she believes this event E, given or conditional on each conditioning event C, that does not contradict E, okay? Note, I'm not saying something which would be utterly stupid, you know, whenever N believes an event, she keeps believing it unless it is contradicted. This is totally stupid, okay? I'm talking about one particular event, and I'm describing under which condition this event is strongly believed. So I fix one event E, and I say when it is strongly believed. It is strongly believed when N keep believing it whenever it is not contradicted by what she observes, okay? This is what I call strong belief. Now, the point is that if you take, you know, a reasonably rich structure, a structure with a reasonably rich set of states, you have the following, that the event up is consistent with Bob being rational, okay? And the event down is consistent with Bob being rational, okay? And therefore, if N strongly believes in the rationality of Bob, then she has to believe in the rationality of Bob, both conditional on up and conditional on down, okay? Now, since the rationality of Bob implies either up left or down right, we can infer that if N strongly believes in the rationality of Bob, okay, then she has these two conditional beliefs, okay? And these are, notice, they are the backward induction beliefs. So when you perform the backward induction analysis of the game, it gives you exactly these two beliefs, okay? Therefore, if we put together rationality of N with the rationality of Bob, with the strong belief of N that Bob is rational, what we get is the backward induction path. Remember, I cannot get backward induction strategies in objective sense. They are not there. They are not in the states of the world. But I can get the backward induction path. And by the way, I also get backward induction beliefs, okay? Conditional beliefs. So there is another way out, which makes sense. It works exactly for the games where backward induction is most compelling, which are two-stage games, okay? And it is the following, okay. N has conditional beliefs about Bob beliefs, so it's about how Bob thinks, okay? And therefore, since how Bob thinks includes what Bob's plan to do, she also has conditional beliefs about the plan of Bob, okay? And we assume that such conditional beliefs, this is an assumption that you can state, you know, formally in the setup, you can assume that such conditional beliefs are independent of what she does. So she has to take an action. What she thinks about what Bob thinks and plan, therefore, is the same before taking the action and after taking the action, because it is conditioned on each one of her possible action, it is always the same. Okay? Own action, independence. Okay? Now, suppose that N also believes whenever possible, which in our structure will mean always, that Bob is materially consistent. So basically, by itself, without other let's say, auxiliary assumptions, material consistency is not falsifiable. You cannot ever observe a move by your opponent that falsifies, you know, the hypothesis that he's moving according to his plan, okay? And therefore, if you strongly believe material consistency, you always believe that your opponent is consistent, okay? So, if you have the following assumptions, independence, N believes that Bob is rational, and N always believes in the material consistency of Bob, okay? These three assumptions imply the same backward induction belief that I pointed out before. So it implies that N would believe left condition on her choosing up, and she would believe right condition on her choosing down. Okay? Now we are not using strong belief in rationality. Now we are using in the joint assumption of independence and the fact that she always thinks that what Bob D, she always thinks that what Bob is going to do is according to his plan, okay? And rationality, which put together consistency and rational planning, is the chain of transmissions from plans to behavior, okay? So we can put together these assumptions, rationality of Bob, of Anne, rationality of Bob, independence, and initially believes that Bob is rational, and she always believed that Bob is materially consistent. And so basically the novelties here with respect to when I had a problem before are you know, that Anne always believed that Bob is materially consistent, and that Anne's beliefs satisfy own action independence, okay? And with this, again, I get the backward induction outcome, except that if I try, let me anticipate it because I know I'm going to fall short of showing you all the slides, okay? So let me anticipate this. Whereas if I try to, so to speak, to extend root one by, you know, stacking assumptions about assumptions about assumptions, or, you know, about higher and higher, higher level beliefs, I can do it, okay, in such a way that I always get the backward induction outcome, and I'll try to give you a hint by looking at that game, okay? If I try to do the same kind of adding assumptions about higher and higher order beliefs with this approach, it doesn't work with games like the Centipede, okay? It works well only in two-stage games, and then some other games, but in general, if I have a game with at least three stages, and you know, if I cook the payoffs in an appropriate way, the extension of this approach will not work. If I have to follow my obsession of getting the backward induction out, I call it an obsession because I think that the goal is not to get the backward induction outcome. The goal is to state assumptions that are reasonable and interesting, and to check what they imply. And if they imply the backward induction outcome, fine. Otherwise, fine. Okay. So this is the Centipede. So let's see how we can work here with our assumption. Okay, the rationality of N has only a weak implication here, namely that this path, CCC, is impossible, because she would go down here. You know, if this point were reached, she would go down here. Then the rationality of Bob, and so now I'm trying to illustrate the extension of my root one with strong belief to a longer game, like the Centipede game, that game, okay? So let's suppose that Bob is rational, and Bob strongly believes that N is rational. The key point here is that, again, if the structure you are working with has sufficiently many states, and there is one structure that it's the only one I really care about, which is called the canonical structure, that in some sense has all the logically possible states, okay? So in that structure and many other, you know, rich structure, basically choice C by N at the beginning is always consistent with the rationality of N. Okay, you can always find states of the world where N is rational and she chooses C. Okay, because of this, if Bob strongly believes in the rationality of N, he has to believe in the rationality of N also after observing C, whether he's surprised or not. He might be surprised because he expected D with probability 1. Doesn't matter, you know. He strongly believes in the rationality of N, and therefore, at this point, conditional on this move, he still gives the rationality of N probability 1, okay? So if we put these two things together, what we get is the following, that since at this point, Bob, you know, strongly believes in the rationality of N, and at this point, too, he would strongly believe in the rationality of N, because no, his move cannot contradict the rationality of N, okay? And so he ascribes to this move the payoff pair 3-0, in particular 0 for him, okay? And because he's rational, he would choose the payoff 2 by going down. And so you see why we have this implication, okay? Bob, if Bob is rational and strongly believes that N is rational, then either N goes down at the beginning of the game, or she continues and Bob goes down, okay? But now we can go on and stack another, you know, higher level hypothesis on the analysis and say, well, but if Anne is rational, and she strongly believes what? That this assumption, that Bob is rational and that Anne strongly believes that Anne is rational, okay? Then basically she's, since this implies that, you know, either she goes down, or we have CD, which has a bad payoff for N, okay? Her rationality yields the move down, okay? And so by assuming some level of rationality, strong belief in rationality, strong belief in the joint assumption of rationality and strong belief in rationality, we obtained the backward induction path. And not only the backward induction path, we also obtained the backward induction beliefs. Okay, now this second feature that we obtain the backward induction beliefs depends on the game, is not something that holds in every perfect information game. So I have no time to show it, but there are simple examples showing that this kind of analysis does not always yield the backward induction beliefs, okay? But it always yields the backward induction path, and this is actually an important theorem in dynamic epistemic game theory. Yes, okay, so basically, I will have, I knew that something like this could happen, okay? So if you want, you know, you can look at the slides in the side. So there is the formal mathematical analysis in which all these, you know, things are defined as, you know, events, okay? Now, let me mention another set of hypotheses that I find interesting, okay? And this is actually a follow-up on a warning that I gave you before. I said, if we try to follow route one, the route with own action independence, and add you know, higher and higher order beliefs, but beliefs held at the beginning of the game, we are not going to get far, okay? We, you know, it works well only with a two-stage game. So this is a three-stages game. So let's try to extend the route two with the independence, with the own action independence. So we know that the rationality of N implies that this path is impossible, CCC is impossible. Now, without the assumption of that Bob strongly believes that Anne is rational, there is a problem that the rationality, assuming that Bob is rational, doesn't have any behavioral implication by itself. We could get behavioral implications only by adding other assumptions. Okay, and why? Well, because Bob could think at the beginning of the game that N would go down. By the way, this is the backward induction prediction, so it is not a wild belief, okay? If he thinks that that N would go down, the rules of conditional probability do not compel him to hold any particular belief about how N would continue afterward when he's surprised by C, okay? And because of this, it may be rational, he may have beliefs that justify the continuation action. Because after all, there is a big three here, okay? Or for other beliefs, he could go down. So we get from the mere assumption that Bob is rational, and even if we assume that Bob initially believes that N is rational, okay, we cannot get the behavioral implication. So we have the following, that suppose that N is rational, Bob is rational, we have own action independence for both N and Bob, okay? and initially believes that Bob is a rational planner, okay? And there is also this independence assumption, okay? And Anne always believe that Bob is consistent, materially consistent, okay? Before, you know, when I had such assumptions in a two-stage game, I got the backward induction strategies, the backward induction outcome and the backward induction beliefs. Now this is not enough, okay? Because these assumptions obviously imply that the CCC prime path cannot happen, okay? But they do not imply more. I mean, that we do not end up here, you know, is a very weak conclusion, right? But basically you can show, and you can show it either by example, by constructing an epistemic structure where this happens, or by a general theorem, you can show that every other outcome, namely these three outcomes, are possible under these assumptions, okay? And then you can also show that, you know, beliefs that are not backward induction beliefs are possible under these assumptions. So basically, the general theorem is exactly a theorem saying, look at these interesting assumptions about initial common belief in rationality and independence and, you know, and belief in material consistency. Always, you know, these assumptions only justify not the iterated deletion of weakly dominated strategies, but only one round of deletion of weakly dominated strategies, followed by as many rounds as you want of strict dominance. Except that here in this game, we would stop after round one, because there is no strict dominance after round one. Okay, and that's the reason essentially why these three outcomes remain possible. So I guess I can stop here.
Very much, Pierpaolo. We have time for maybe a couple of minutes for questions, if there are any.
Yep.
I find this mind blowing, but apart from that, maybe you said that, but it's not clear to me. If when you said, you showed us some conditions in the examples that allow us to identify the backward induction equilibrium. Can you clarify how much general they are, or better, which are the basic conditions which guarantee that you fall back to it, even though you don't think it's interesting? Maybe.
The point is that the assumptions are formulated in a recursive way, and I have here them on the slides, and I can show them to you. Okay. So since you got a flavor of what are the meanings of these symbols, okay? So I can define within my type structure, I can define rationality. And then I have a recursive definition. You know, I say player I is an RI K plus one guy, okay? If he's an RIK guy, so which means rational and many other things, okay? And furthermore, he strongly believes, so he believes whenever possible, that player minus I is also an RK guy, okay? So if K is equal to one, this is just, equal to zero, this is just the rationality assumption, okay? And therefore, here you would have R1 means you are player I is rational and he strongly believes in the rationality of the other guy. And then you can go on and pile up these assumptions that imply, in a sense, they imply how players do believe revision when they are surprised, okay? Now, these assumptions, if you take a sufficiently rich type structure, like the only structure I care about, which is the canonical one, by the way, I also have slides for the canonical structures here, and I'm not going to show them, okay? Then you can show that basically these assumptions that altogether I call common strong belief in rationality, in every game of perfect information without ties, so the class of games considered here, imply the backward induction path. Okay? But they also justify a solution concept called extensive form rationalizability that in most games coincides with the iterated deletion of weakly dominated strategies. And this is the fundamental theorem of this paper.
Any more questions? Well, if not, let's thank Pierpaolo again.